Welcome to Qt Widgets and More. Let me just show you what this episode is all about. In here, you can see a table view, and the table view has, as always, a header view over here on the site, but this header view has checkboxes. And when I play the songs, I'll be actually interacting with those. Let me show you how I got that working. Let me be the first to admit that the design of the model view APIs could be better. But there's one thing in here that is mind-boggling beautiful, and that is that the header on top of your tables or on the side of your trees, namely QHeaderView, actually is a subclass of QAbstractItemView, which means that you can customize them just like you customize the cells of your tables. So if you want to change the font or the color, foreground or background, or the tooltip, or any of the other properties for a single column header, all you need to do is just to do it exactly as if you would have done had it been a single cell in the table. You'll namely return new values from your header data. But that's one thing that is missing, and that is checkboxes and the ability to interact with them. So I'll show you how I re-added that. It shows you a small little trick that is worthwhile knowing about QHeaderView and model views, table view and tree views. So I have a table view table, and I have a model, Depeche model. Yeah, you're small now, right? Small, smiling out loud. That's okay. Depeche mode model. So that's, I'm a Depeche mode fan. I've told you that many times. My model is put to work on the table, or the table has the model set model here. That's regular model view to you up until this point. The trick, however, is that I create a new header view, which is a subclass of Q header view, and that one I adapt slightly. I set the header view on my table using this set vertical header. One thing to be aware of when you do that is that by default, when you are using the default header view, then these two lines here are executed by QTableView, but they are not when you call setVerticalHeader, so you need to call them yourself, given that you want this facility. CheckableHeaderView is a subclass of QHeaderView. You might expect that there is, in the code behind the scenes here, instances of QCheckbox, but that's not the case actually. I just draw a rectangle and your brain thinks that it's a checkbox. Well, I don't even draw the rectangle myself. I let QStyle draw the rectangle. But to get that rectangle drawn in this area, I need a few things. First of all, I need to make space for that rectangle. That's what my size hint is about. That's the size hint of the QHeaderView plus the area for the checkbox. I need to actually paint it. I do that in paint section. And finally, I need to behave like a checkbox, which I do by subclassing, well, which I do by overriding the mouse press event. And that's where I'll do my magic, whether it's checked or unchecked. Before we go to the CPP file and see the code, let me just tell you how I actually came up with this rather complex code. I looked at the superclasses implementation. There wasn't any good, super clean way of hooking myself in. I would have liked if there was a method like paint background and paint the text itself and so on, but there wasn't. It was all in paint section. But I had the opportunity of looking at that code, which I haven't stressed out enough in this Qt Widgets and More, so let me just do it now. Do install the source code of Qt itself so that you can look in the implementation of those things that you override and get inspired from it. So here is what the code looks like. First of all, I have a margin, and instead of cluttering my code with force all over the place, I give it a name, margin, and I make it a static const expert up here so that my compiler can put that for in place in all of the right places. My checkbox size, that is the small rectangle that I draw, its height will be exactly the same as the font that I have here. So I calculate that here, font metric dot height, that's the checkbox size. The area that the checkbox is going to sit in is going to be first 4 pixels of margin, then the width of the checkbox itself, and then another 4 pixels of margin, and that's what you see down here. So that actually allows me to implement size hint. Size hint is simply the size hint of the original plus those 4 plus the rectangle plus 4 pixels that I have here in checkbox area width, comma 0. So enjoy the beauty of this code simply because qsize has an operator plus implemented. Okay, let's see the painting code itself. It's up here. I did get inspired from my Q header view :: paint section, which has a lot of this Q style in it. So first of all, let me just jump down to where I paint the rest that's not the checkbox area. So I do that by simply saying paint a save and paint a restore. Honestly, I don't understand why my paint section doesn't do that, but without the paint a save and restore, I actually got in a state where, well, I just didn't see my checkboxes. So paint a save, paint a restore, and then I paint the section. That's my superclass. I tell just paint it as if I wasn't here with this painter. And that's the exactly same API as you see up here with the logical index. And then with this inside this rectangle, which has just been shifted checkbox area with pixels to the right. The width and the everything else here is exactly the same. So rect.adjusted just takes the rectangle and just moves the left border. I wonder if it's the right or right direction here for you, but moves it these number of pixels in. That's painting the area itself. Then I also did the painting of the checkbox, which I now do by, and how did I get to this code? Well, I looked into how does QCheckbox actually paint itself. So I create a QStyle option button. I figure out what is the size here. That's the size of the checkbox itself. And then the rectangle that I'm going to paint this in is the rectangle that I got in. So my original rectangle here is left margin or left size plus the margin. And from the top, it's a rectangle top plus, well, this is what makes sure that the rectangle is in the center of the item, comma size. And then whether the checkbox should be checked or not, I get that from the model where I ask for its header data and I ask for the check state role. So I go to the model, I ask for the header data for this item that I'm about to paint. I ask whether it should be checked or not. And if it's checked, then I set option.state with this state on, otherwise state off. And in any case, I make it also paint as if it is enabled. Maybe if it was possible to disable individual items, I would need to modify this code. But in my code, at least it isn't. And then I call style draw primitive a checkbox with this stuff here. And all of this beauty here is the beauty of painting using the QStyle API. No, that's not going to be an episode on how to paint with QStyle because that is way above, below. Besides my pay grade, I just don't understand how QStyle painting works. We have people for that. Anyway, this was my original code. Paint the item, paint the checkbox. It worked fine until I actually changed the background color of the header. And that's where I need to clear the area. So that's what the rest of this code does. I ask my model again, the header data, for this particular logical index for the background color row. Then I call save and I call restore. I set up the style option, and that's where I looked very much into the paint section of QHeaderView. And this is exactly what that one does. So I paint this stuff here, and yeah, I don't even understand this code, but that's what clears the background and draw the line in between items in my HeaderView. So obviously, whether the item should be checked or not is something that belongs in the model. And as you saw, my code for painting went to the model and asked for whether it was checked or not, have a look yourself at the mouse area. That one just goes to the model again and set whether it should be checked or not using set header data. So let's go to the model in as a final step here and look at its header data and set header data. So my Depeche Mode model, or in short, Depeche model, header data looks like this. As always, I need to check for the role. Is it the display role? Then all of this stuff here. Otherwise, go to my data structure and figure out at this section, what is the album? And let me just show you the data structure real super easy. It's a vector of data and the data looks like this itself. And up here at the top, you can see my setting up my data. It looks like this. I absolutely didn't do anything to make this fancy because it is just some example data. Your data structure will very, very likely be very different from mine here. So my header data, finding it again. If it is, if the data looks like, well, I'll just go and get the data for the display role. If we're talking about the check state role instead, then I'll check whether the orientation is vertical, because it was only in vertical that I had the option of check state. And bool to state, very simple method here, just translating a bool into checked or unchecked. And again, my data structure for this m underscore selected is a vector of bools. So that's how I'll get my data. The background color role, just so that I could show you that I was able to handle background color. These are my two favorite albums. So section 5 and section 6, that's the background that I changed there. Notice that we talked about data inside of my items. I would have overridden a flags method, but there is no header flags to override. So in here and together between my subclass of QHeaderView and this model, that's where I need to tell whether there's checkbox items or not. I could have done it smarter in many ways if I wanted to make it more generic so that my checkbox, my QHeaderView subclass were actually able to draw the checkbox depending on the model. But then again, I need to set the Q checkbox or the checkable. Let me go to main and show you. That's the line I'm talking about. I need to set it myself, so there isn't all that much of a need for the flags method, for the header flags it would have been called. And finally, set header data. You don't usually override that, but fortunately they did remember to offer you that. That's where I'm checking whether it's this check state role and the vertical one. And if that is the case, then I will set the value here of the item being checked. I need to remember to emit my header data changed, because otherwise the header will actually not notice it itself. So try and check that out. Usually, if you forget to emit data changed, then the view will be smart enough to notice that you actually edit this cell and update it nevertheless. But the header view actually do not even call the paint event from interacting. Of course it doesn't. It doesn't even know that I was interacting. That was me that was overriding the mouse press event and interacting. So I definitely need to remember to override my, or to call my header data changed signal.